guys, John from FlyMikeAlpha.com, and today I'm here to talk to you about spins. We're going to talk about what a spin is, what it looks like, how to enter into one of the spins, and also, more importantly, how to recover from a spin, and extra important, how to recover at the first sign of a spin, rather than actually going all the way into it. So the first thing we're going to do is climb up to a good safe altitude over top of the airport here where we're clear of all traffic and in a position to land in case we had a problem with the aircraft. And we're going to put the aircraft into a spin deliberately. I'll talk you through those control inputs, but typically it has something to do with stalling the airplane and having the ball lay off to the side, having an uncoordinated stall. So to do so, I'm simply going to go ahead, clear the area here, make sure there's no other aircraft around us. And once I'm satisfied I'm at a good altitude, we're clear, make sure there's no other airplanes near us, we'll make a radio call, let everyone know where we are, what we're doing, and then enter into the procedure. The procedure is going to be stick full back to raise the nose, power at about 1500 RPM or so. We don't want too much power, but we need a little bit to make the aircraft spin. We don't want too much to make it into a very aggressive spin. And then full left rudder, and that's going to bring me right into a spin. Now, as soon as the aircraft stalls, we'll notice the left wing dropping. At that point, we should be stepping on the right rudder to step on the high wing and lower that wing, but we're going to do the wrong thing and hold in full left rudder and hold the stick full aft, and as we see the ground and get scared, we're going to continue to pull full back on the stick and hold the aircraft in a spin. When I want to recover, I'll do my normal spin recovery procedure. Pair, power to idle, ailerons neutral, opposite rudder the direction of the spin, and briskly pushing the elevator forward to break the stall and recover from the resulting dive by pulling the nose up and adding full power once we get our nose up even or above the horizon. We'll go ahead and do one last clearing turn here to make sure that we're clear. Venice traffic, Silver Champ, over the field, maneuvering 2,000 and above Venice traffic. That way, we're well above 2,000 feet here, but we're kind of buying ourselves a block altitude of airspace to try to keep other airplanes away from us as we go through these aggressive maneuvers. Alright, I'm noting my heading. Everything's set, gauges look green. Check the area one last time. I'm going to go ahead, set power back to 1500 so I don't get into too aggressive of a spin here. Pull the stick full back. And as I'm raising my nose, right before I get to the stall, I'm going to go ahead and kick in full left rudder. And now we are going in the incipient phase, and here is the develop phase of the spin. We're spinning down, I'm looking at my altitude. I've got about 2,600, passing through that. Now to recover from this, I'm going to go power to idle, opposite rudder, pushing the stick forward. There we are, I'm flying again. Airspeed's coming up awful quickly, so I'm pulling back on the stick, got my nose up in with the horizon, and full power, climbing away. Now, I'm doing all that stuff a little bit faster than I can even talk, so it happens awful quickly.
I saw that on the radio.
Now, you may say that I would never do something that stupid. I would never pull the stick full back and apply full left rudder and make the aircraft enter into a spin. Well, okay, I'll buy that. You know, sure, you won't do something that dumb. However, pilots, unfortunately, die in spins every year, and not just one guy a year. It's lots of pilots kill themselves in a base and final turn in a spin. And why that is, well, it's for a number of reasons. There's never one single factor that causes an accident. There's always an accident chain. And so let's talk a little bit about that accident chain as we climb back up here. Well, you probably overshot base to final. It's probably a gusty day, and there was probably some sort of reason making you feel like you have to make this landing, feel like you have to make the turn tighter and turn back to final, rather than just adding full power, going around to the side of the runway and climbing back towards the runway in a safe manner and trying again. So what could those factors be? Well, let's say we're in a Cessna 172, we just flew a 2-hour cross country and we're coming back, the weather's not good, it's a little gusty, normally we would have stopped by now, but, you know, we continued to press on anyways because we had passengers with us. We had two people in the backseat of that 172, maybe it was all four people, high gross weight, high stall speed, and we had baggage with us too, so we were at gross weight, higher stall speed, and we had an aft center of gravity. So now we're setting up for a not good scenario just to begin with. Then let's say we go ahead and we're coming in a little fast, so we trim more nose up. So I'm going to go ahead and set my trim here way nose up. So now we're trimmed aft and we got an aft CG, so the nose is pitching up, the aircraft's getting dangerously slow, and we happen to have a strong gusting crosswind. And so we're on a left base and we have a crosswind for the runway coming ultimately from the left if we were on final. And that makes our base light go by very fast, and we overshoot base to final. And so what ends up happening is, with about power set here, and about a decent power setting, I go ahead and I start to bank to the left. And as I bank to the left, I'm overshooting, so I kick left rudder. I don't like how much the aircraft's banking. My passengers go, so I push right stick. And now I notice my nose is dropping, and I pull back on the stick. And this is just so wrong, but oh my god, there's the ground. I keep the stick full back, and now I'm in a spin again. I have to apply full opposite rudder, power to idle, push the stick forward, recover, and raise my nose back up. I don't care about turning to the runway at this point. I just care about living. I'm adding full power, pushing forward on that stick to fight the trim and fight that app-center gravity with all those passengers in the back. And there we go. We've recovered. Now, on that maneuver, we lost about 200 feet or so. If you're base to final at 500 feet and you recover immediately, then, hey, you could still live. But what happens most of the time is when you see that ground coming up at you, you pull the stick full aft and you hold the aircraft in that spin. Now, obviously things were wrong with the airplane. We could hear it, we could feel it, it didn't like what we were doing to it. So why did we do that? Well, again, we had an aft center of gravity, we had the trim set nose up, and maybe we didn't pull the aircraft into a spin, or into a stall rather, we didn't pull the aircraft into a stall and then make it end up spinning because of uncoordinated use of the controls. Perhaps the aircraft was just above stall speed. We were watching it carefully, but it was a gusty day, remember, and we had a little bit of headwind, and it sheared from 20 knots down to 10, and we lost 10 knots of airspeed just like that, and all of a sudden, the left wing stalls and we roll over. So what we really want to practice here, and what you'll do in training with your CFI if you go through spin training, is practicing recovering at the incipient phase of the spin, right before the aircraft enters into the spin, into the stall, right when you realize something's going terribly wrong. So let's talk about what that looks like. We've got the runway off to our left, our imaginary runway. I've overshot it. I'm going to go ahead and kick left rudder while I'm banking the airplane left. I don't like how much I'm banking, so I push right stick. Oh, my nose dropped. I pull back, and I notice something's wrong. I'm going to go ahead and recover now with right rudder, pushing the stick forward, recovering from the stall, raising my nose back up, adding full power, climbing away. On that one, we didn't even lose 100 feet. We recovered at the first sign of something going wrong, and the main factor of recovery was don't pull back and use rudder opposite the direction of rotation. Our nose was sliding to the left, I pushed right rudder. I could step on the ball, you could say that, but come on, really, when you're staring at the ground and you're scared and the airplane's doing things you're not used to, are you really going to be staring at the ball? You're probably going to be looking out over the nose and freezing in panic as you see the ground rushing up at you. So, if you see the nose sliding left, step on right rudder. If you see the nose sliding to the right, step on left rudder. Whichever way the aircraft may be entering into a spin, step on that rudder. The other way to think about this is, step on the high wing. When we enter into that maneuver, we're clear here, the left wing is dropping. If I just step on the right rudder, I can level the wings and keep the airplane flying straight without going into a spin. I don't necessarily have to put in control inputs as long as I'm using rudder and keeping the wings level with rudder. Rudder will be probably the most important tool you use here. And let's go ahead and clear the area one more time for ourselves. So now let's go ahead and try this and just let go. At the first sign of something going terribly wrong, let's just let go and see if the aircraft actually enters into a spin or not. And I bet, actually, that we won't go into a spin. We'll rather go into a spiral where we're not fully stalled. We're maybe in a dive, in a spiraling dive towards the ground, but our airspeed is above stall speed. If you notice on that other spin, our airspeed was hanging around 40 as we were going through those rotations. So, let me go ahead and just put the aircraft into that bad situation again, overshooting our runway, so I'm going to go ahead and bank to the left, kick left rudder, oh, too much bank, right stick, pulling back, and, oh man, I just really don't like this, something is definitely wrong, I'm just going to let go, and guess what, the airplane's still flying, I can go ahead and recover it normally, using coordinated rudder and aileron. So just letting go sometimes can help you figure out what's going wrong. Now let me pull it into a little bit more aggressive spin there, or incipient phase of a spin. We'll actually get the airplane to stall this time, and then just let go once it's stalled and see if it recovers on its own. Bumping a little more power there. And now, I will let go, but I'm also going to reduce power to idle, because leaving power in is definitely going to keep the aircraft into a spin. Our area is clear, no other aircraft around, raising my nose. And I'm kicking left rudder, I'm entering into that spin, and now I'm just going to go ahead and let go. Power to idle, and guess what, look at that, as soon as power came to idle, the aircraft started to recover. I'm going to go ahead and recover from this dive here, because we don't want to get too fast. The most dangerous part about practicing these is actually getting the aircraft too fast, or overstressing the airframe with G-forces on the pullout. So just by letting go and reducing power to idle, the aircraft stops spinning. Now, not all airplanes will do that, but I bet most of them will. Most important thing to take away here is rudder is probably your best friend. A along with power not being pushed in. When the aircraft starts misbehaving, get rid of your power. Hopefully you have at least enough altitude to train for airspeed. Even if you're only at a few hundred feet, you're probably better off getting rid of power. And then, also, use rudder. Don't use the stick. Use rudder. Use the stick and rudder together, but more importantly, use rudder. Do not leave your feet on the floor like so many students who fly Pipers and Cessnas do. You must use rudder, and you must use it as much as it takes, pretty authoritatively, pretty aggressively. When the aircraft starts rolling over on its back to the left, if I'm in a 90-degree bank here and I want to fix that, I can just go ahead and press right rudder, and the aircraft will fix itself. Alright, much more so than aileron will do when you're in a stall. When you're stalled, the ailerons will not help, they will only make it worse. So, your takeaway here, power and rudder, those are your two best friends. Also, don't get yourself into those bad situations. Don't be trimmed way nose up. Don't be flying an airplane at gross weight with people in the back, with an absent center of gravity, on a gusty day, when you're pressed for time and making poor decisions. Stack the deck in your favor. Do everything you can to ensure a positive outcome of your flight, and even if that means delaying your passengers or delaying your flight a little bit, not the end of the world. You can always do it tomorrow. If you push it, you might not be able to do it tomorrow. So, rudder, power, be safe, think through things. Everything will be all right. Our area is clear. Let's go ahead and have some fun here.
Hey guys, thanks so much for watching, and thank you so much for sharing us on Facebook, Twitter, and all the other social media sites. If you have any questions about the video at all, just leave them in the comments below and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Be sure to give us a thumbs up on our video, and you can subscribe to us to keep up with all our latest episodes right over here on the right. Also, check out some of these other helpful videos below, and remember, if you can't fly every day, then fly at mikealpha.com. We'll see y'all next time.